Thanks for being here. So I'd like to talk about Jun, which is a tool we started about 2 years ago at Jane Street, the company I work for, and we still work on it. So I'd like to show you what it is, what you can do with it, and so how it can help you develop native OCaml horizon application. So just to give you an idea of why we started this tool, just imagine that we are 2 years ago, and you want to write your first OCaml application. So you start, and in front of you, you have many different independent tools. And to develop and publish your application, you will need to use all of these tools. You will need to make them work together, but you will have to do all of this yourself. So it's already quite a challenge, but you are motivated, so you do it. You go ahead, you assemble everything, and when you are ready, you start actually developing your application, building it, and then something goes wrong in the stack, and the tool tells you, the system tells you, okay, actually, I can't manage to build your tool, and I know you can't do anything with it, but I'm going to give you 2 pages of error that you can't understand. And that was really the world 2 years ago, basically, and it was really painful. And for us at Jane Street, it was really painful because we had been releasing open source OCaml software for a long time, and every week we had to deal with this problem. And so at some point, what we did is we just took a step back and we looked at it and we said, okay, all of these tools, what exactly do they do? What is their job, right? And so basically what you have this black box, all of these tools in the middle. On one side, you have the user who just wants to write application, OCaml libraries, etc. And on the other side, the output of this tool is basically a compilation pipeline. It's just calling the OCaml compiler in the right order to assemble your final application. And when you just look at it this way, it just felt like it was way too complicated and that we could simplify it a lot. And that was the idea of Jun originally, that was just re-implement everything from scratch into one single coherent tool. And the immediate result of this is that the build times started being really, really faster. Like on average, it was 10 times faster when projects were switching to do it into state time faster, and some users ever reported up to 50 times faster. So very quickly, people started adopting it, and today it is like the standard tool for writing OCaml application. It has really become a community project with a lot of people getting involved. It is entirely developed on GitHub. It's using an MIT license. And I just wanted to say that because I think it explains very well what are the two main drivers of the project. What we try to have is a really fast build and a very simple and coherent user experience. And that comes from how we started this tool and why we did it. So now I'd like to talk a bit more about what is Jun, you know, how you can use it to develop application. So Jun, it's a modern and fast build system for OCaml or Reason. So you can use the OCaml syntax, Reason syntax as you want. It can build native application. It can easily cross-compile application for various architecture. You can also use it to do JavaScript applications and many more. So to start with, how do you configure it? What is the interface you have with the tool? And it is mainly configured via Jun files. So that takes the name of the tool. And the two important points about the configuration files is that, first of all, they are very descriptive, right? You just describe what your project is about. So typically, you might say, I have an executable called Hello World. Inside this code, I'm using libraries called mylib, and I pre-process it with some PP accelerator. And the second point is that they are close to what they describe. So the tool doesn't enforce any specific organization. You don't need to have a bin directory, a lib directory, etc. If you want to have a binary into src bin, you can do it, it's up to you. And you will just drop this Jun file at any point in the tree, wherever there is something Jun should know about. So the description language is quite simple, it's yet quite powerful. So typically, one thing we do very often in OCaml is have code generators. So you have a program that you will build, execute in order to produce more code that you will then include in your application. And that is something we do all the time in OCaml. So any build system for OCaml will support it. And with Jun, it's very easy. At any point in the tree, you can inject a custom rule, a custom way to produce an ML file, or JSON file for what is worth, by just telling Dune like how to run your generator, where to store the output, etc. So you have a small portable DSL to describe these things. And once you have done this, you know, you have described what your project is about. So you can ask Dune to build things. So it's quite simple CLI. For example, if you want to build and execute a program, you just say Dune exec the program. Dune comes packed with many tools that are useful for development. So for example, in OCaml, we have a top level that lets us enter OCaml expression and get the result straight away. And Dune gives you an easy way to provide the user with a top level in which you can access all the functions that are defined in your project. So for example, here, I'm calling Dune Utop. So Utop is the name of the main top level for OCaml with a directory. And inside this top level, I can use anything that's defined in SRC. If you try to do that by hand, it's a little bit painful, but Dune tries to basically wrap that up nicely and provide you with a very simple CLI. And obviously, it supports all the command stuff. So typically, when you develop native application, you want to install them on your system. So you can ask Dune to build everything that you want to install. You can ask it to build your documentation. So typically, all your API documentation, your generated HTML documentation. You can ask it to run the test. So you can see here, I put this at, and typically, it's what you call an alias in Dune. It's to mean something general, right? Not just a single program, but just a generic thing. So it's like high-level orders. And so something Anil talked before is the composability aspect. So you can just take any two Dune projects, put them together, and Dune will see them as just one single thing, right? And it's not just the case of it will build the first one and then the second one. It's really the case that it is exactly like if you developed a single project right from the start. Typically, it's something that I added at the beginning because I was maintaining a few open source software. And so I had a lot of dependency between the software, and I was often adding features that crossed all the projects. And that was really painful because I had to go through the first project, do some changes, build it, install it, then go to the second project, do some more changes, build, install. And that was very, very frustrating. And so when I started doing Dune, I just put everything I wanted to have, right? And I put this aspect in it. And what does that give you? Well, first of all, because Dune has a global view of the whole code, you know, it can provide much faster builds. Because you don't just go through every single package one by one and build them with parallelism inside. You just compile everything at once, and you have the maximum parallelism possible, right? That makes rendering extremely easy with Dune. You just copy the source of your dependency inside your substrate, and they become part of your project. And finally, one feature it unlocks is large-scale refactoring. So just imagine you have a library, and this library is used by 100 projects. And you want to do a breaking change in this library and upgrade your 100 projects. Well, the reason is quite easy. You will just clone your library, clone your 100 projects. You will do the change in your library, and then you ask Dune to build everything. And what will happen is that you will get compilation error because you did a breaking change. So you just follow them one by one, upgrade the code to match what you did in your library. And just like that, you can upgrade everything at once. And if you try to do that without Dune, obviously it's very painful. And that's something Dune allows you to do. And so as Anil was saying, like, you know, where we want to have everything building with Dune, if you imagine a world where all the OCaml projects are building with Dune, you can effectively break the stdlib and upgrade everything at once. So testing with Dune. So obviously, testing is a very important part of software development. And we spend, because we want a good user experience with Dune, we spend quite a lot of time thinking about how to have good testing strategy. And in particular, one thing we have put a lot of focus on is expectation testing. So expectation testing, it's the idea that you capture what your test produces and you save it as expectation. So just a simple example, here I have a binary called hello that's supposed to print hello world. I will save in a file hello that expected what I expect this test to print. So here I put blah, which is the wrong output. And then I ask June to run the test. And it will tell you, it will show me like what the test, what was expected and what the test actually printed. And I can see what actually, what it actually printed is what should be expected. So I can just tell June, okay, well, just use that as the normal expectation. So I do June promote, and it will copy the file to my source tree, and that becomes the new expectation. And that's very useful, you know, when you work with a big collection of tests to have this very well integrated. And we support also like inline expectation testing, where you put both like the code of your test and the expectation inside the same file. So you can have everything, you can see everything in one go, what your test is about and what it produces. And it works exactly the same. You can run the neural test and it will show you what is actually, what is the actual output of the test, and you can accept it the same way, etc. There is also nice editor integration. So currently it's mostly with Emacs because most of the developer is Emacs, where you can, inside Emacs, ask for the file you are visiting to be promoted. And that gives you the impression that you evaluate things inside your editor, you know, which is very nice. That provides a nice way of like doing some kind of exploratory programming, you know, where you write something, you see what it produces. And it's repeatable as well, right? If you rerun it again, it will do the same thing. And finally, just a word about integration test. We have, so this thing is like how you would define like a custom test engine. So it's just saying that when the user does build the at-run test or call the run test, you should also run this action. And the interesting bit here is that I specify a dependency on not just some files, but on a whole package, you know, a package being a collection of binaries and libraries that you distribute. And what it means is that when June will execute this action, it will execute it in an environment that is similar to the one you would get if you had first installed your package. It's like if you do make install and then you do your test, except that it's all integrated. So what that means is that if I go and modify the code of my package, June will automatically rebuild it and rerun the test because it knows that the package has changed. And that's a very powerful thing. And for example, we use it a lot in June itself. When someone reports a bug and they provide a small reproduction case, what we do is that we simply import the reproduction case in our source tree and we have a test like this. And we can very easily grow our regression test base, basically, and improve the quality of the software over time with very little overhead, basically. All right, so Dune also support producing JavaScript application. So we support it via JS of OCaml, which is a project a bit similar to VocalScript. So we support two modes. We have a development mode where you get fast incremental compilation, but big JS files. And then a release mode, where the second time you rebuild, after you do a change, you will pretty much redo everything from scratch, so it will be long. However, you get a small JS file. And in order to benefit from it, there is nothing special you need to do. You don't need to add any configuration. You just ask June to build this bc.js, and it already knows how to do all this. It will just compile your file as a JavaScript file. We also support cross-compilation out of the box. So as long as you have like all the cross-compiler installed on our system, you can just ask June to build for various architecture, and it will provide you the different binaries for the various architecture in the build directory at different places. So what's interesting here is that we have this, in underscore build, you have this name like default.windows, default.android, etc. So in Dune, that's what we called a build context. And the idea is that in a single run of Dune, it can maintain all these separate world, this parallel world, and build in them, and have several different configurations in each of them. So typically, like in the default.windows world, it will use an OCaml compiler targeting Windows. In this, it will use an OCaml compiler targeting Android, etc. And what's interesting is that because it can represent them all in a single one, it can use tools from each other. So typically, I told you before that we use a lot of code generators in OCaml. And code generators are quite a pain when you do cross-compilation because obviously you need to build and execute a program while you are compiling. So you use a different compiler for the generator than for the code you generate. And with this method, it's all quite straightforward because if you need to run a tool during your build, you will just use the one from the world that targets the machine you are currently building on. So effectively, when we started adding support for cross-compilation in June, there was some work to do in June. But after that, pretty much all the projects that are portable, they immediately cross-compile without doing anything. There was just already enough information for June to do all the cross-compilation. So that was really nice. Okay, so just a word about using June with Easy. So if you have been using ResonML, you are probably quite familiar with it. So Easy is a tool for providing a good workflow to develop applications. So there is nothing, like June and Easy are quite independent. However, there have been good communication between the June team and the Easy team. And effectively, they work quite well together. So what that means is that if you develop an application with June and you publish it, it will be really easy for someone using Easy to use your project with Easy, basically, to use it as a dependency of the project that will be Easy. So if you want to use it, there is nothing really special. You just add OpenDune to your package.json. You just drop a couple of Dune files in your project, and then you just call Easy and build, and it will just work as expected. All right, so I'm finished describing a bit the feature of Dune. I would just like to talk in the last section about some design choice we made in Dune and that we are quite attached to. So the first design choice we made is that Dune is a complete build system. It's not just a front-end or a back-end. So for example, you have in build system, you have things like Ninja that are just doing the low-level stuff, and then some tools on top that will just provide the user experience, while Dune does everything. And what that gives us is a lot of freedom to do exactly what we want, basically. Secondly, we attach a lot of importance to backward compatibility. In particular, we want that upgrading is a no-brainer. If someone says, well, I have a problem with Dune 1.3, and we fix the problem with Dune 1.4, we are just able to say, well, just upgrade, and everything will still work, because we have made sure that it's properly backward compatible. But still, we are able to change things, right? So Anil before talked about, so Dune started as a JBuilder, and then was renamed to Dune. And when we did this renaming, we changed not only the name, but a lot of other things. We changed the name of the configuration file. We changed the syntax inside this file, etc. But today, you are still able, with the latest version of Dune, to build a project that was released using the very original version of JBuilder, because we provide full backward compatibility. And we think that's quite important, right? Because we want to support everybody's workflow. Right? So there will be some people that are able to keep up with the latest evolution very quickly, and some people that have less time to spend on their development and that want to release something and have it work for a long time. So obviously, it's not in 10 years, it will probably be a bit different. We don't support things from now, but when we plan to start dropping features, we announce it long in advance. For example, right now, we are planning next year to drop some of the original features, and we announced it in the middle of this year for the end of next year, essentially. And the way we do that is that the user will simply state the version of Dune it expects in his project. So typically, when you develop, if at the time you are using Dune 1.4, you will just write Dune 1.4 in your project. And when later on you will use a newer version of Dune, Dune will see this, and it will adapt its behavior to match the behavior that it had at version 1.4. And essentially, what that allows is that when you have Dune 2 that will have breaking changes, it will still be able to understand older projects and build them. So that allows basically Dune to stay fresh and modern while still providing a long-term support for users. So in particular, when I say it adapts its behavior, right? If you write this, so long Dune 1.4, and then you are using a feature that is deprecated in a newer version of Dune, Dune will not complain about it because it knew that in this version, it was a feature that wasn't deprecated. And so Anil showed that before in his talk, but we always try to provide helpful error message so that, for example, if you try to the feature that is more recent than this, Dune will tell you it's not possible and will tell you why, so that you know what to do. Finally, so one thing we have been trying to enforce from the start is that when there are several ways of doing the same thing, but overall they just produce the same outcome, instead of supporting everything, we'll just choose one way and we'll implement it well, and we'll support it well, rather than try to do everything badly, basically. Okay, so now just a last word about what are the future plans for Dune. So we want to automate a few more things, in particular less configuration file, right? When you start a new project, you have to write so configuration file for Dunes, for Travis, for AppVior, for Easy, etc. And we want to make it easier for the user to only know about Dune, because like you do need your build system to know to build your project. And then Dune can take charge of configuring everything else. So in particular, we have been talking about this thing with Easy, for example, to have Easy read Dune configuration files. And people are quite happy with this idea, so it's likely that it will happen at some point. Another thing we are looking at is making incremental build scale properly. So right now, if you use Dune on a very, very large project or a very large collection of projects, so for example, a few million lines of code, what will happen is that the first build will be as fast as you want. But then when you start doing small changes, even if there is not a lot of work to do, you will still pay a price of a few seconds, you know, for Dune to just read the configuration and do all internal work, etc. And we have been looking at more like modern ideas that come from research to make all this much faster, to share a lot more like the work that Dune does across invocation or even in the future across workspaces, like the idea of cloud build essentially. And as we go, we'll integrate new ideas, workflows. So for example, recently we added support for code autoformatter. So you can ask Dune to check that your project is correctly formatted. For example, in your CI, you can tell Dune to check that my project is formatted, and if someone does a pull request but doesn't format their code with the REFMT or OCaml format for OCaml, you will get an error, and then you can tell the person to run another command to just automatically reformat everything. And that ensures like a consistent style across your whole project. Okay, so that's all I wanted to say, so if you have any questions.